up, everybody? Thank you for tuning in. I want to give you just a few quick updates concerning how we are moving and shaking during COVID-19. Number one, make sure that you and everybody you know spread this. Take out your cell phones, text the word STAR to 94253. I want to make sure that I'm able to remain in contact with you and you are able to stay updated with information from us as to the decisions that we are making during this COVID-19 pandemic. Text the word STAR to 94253. Number two, if you live in Birmingham, Alabama, or Cincinnati, Ohio, I'm inviting you to watch the Follow the STAR telecast, Birmingham, Alabama. Join us every morning, 6 a.m., CW21, Monday through Friday. Cincinnati, Ohio, join us every Sunday, 8:30 a.m., Eastern Standard Time on CW12. Follow the STAR from wherever you are. Number three, those of you that are watching this from anywhere in the world, I am inviting you to pray with us. Every single morning, start your day 6:30 a.m. Central Standard Time on the prayer line with the STAR. I'm leading it every single morning during this COVID-19 pandemic. There are two ways to access the prayer line. Facebook Live @PastorBeavers or dial that number on the screen, 712-775-7031, access code 520-068-905#. Number four, I'm inviting you to tell everybody you know as well as yourself, tune in to our live online virtual worship experience every Sunday, 10 a.m. Central Standard Time, every single Wednesday, 7 p.m., our I Study at the STAR Bible Study, 7 p.m. Central Standard Time on Wednesdays. There are several ways that you can access our live online virtual worship experiences. Facebook, the church Facebook page, New Rising STAR Church, the STAR, or go to Facebook, type in the tag handle @BeatMeToTheStAR. YouTube, type in #TeamSTAR, or simply just go to the website. This is my favorite way, www.beatmetothestar.net. To all that have been giving your resources during this COVID-19 crisis, sowing into the good ground of the STAR, I want to say thank you. Number five, I want to invite you to continue to be faithful in the giving of your tithe and your offering. The building is shut down. The church is not shut down. I believe that the church is the answer to the world, especially in a time of crisis. Salvation is free, but it costs to do ministry. Thank you for those who have been giving. And I want to remind everybody of the ways that you are able to give. You can give in person, Monday through Friday, 9 a.m. to 4:30 p.m. We only let people in the building, 8 people at a time. You can give in person every Sunday, 9 a.m. to 2 p.m. You can mail it, 7400 London Avenue, South Birmingham, Alabama, 35206. Not only can you mail it, but guess what? We have a 24-hour-a-day, 7-day-a-week, 365-day-a-year drop box on the outside of the church office. But I really want to push everyone to give online, beatmetothestar.net/give. Give by text. Text any amount, 5, 10, 15, 25,000, 500,000. It does not matter what it is, to 855-912-7781. You can cash app, $BeatMeToTheStAR, Venmo @BeatMeToTheStAR. Last but not least, if you are in Birmingham, Alabama, or the surrounding areas and you are in need of food, not hoarding food, but you are sincerely in need of food, every Wednesday, 12 noon, right here at the STAR, we have a drive-through food box distribution line for you. Our team is outside with our gloves, we are outside with our mask, and we are ready to serve the community. God bless you. Follow the STAR from wherever you are. Peace.
Oh, give thanks unto the Lord, for he is good. Hallelujah. Can you just open up your mouth and just bless the wonderful, mighty name of Jesus? Hallelujah. He is worthy to be praised. He's worthy of glory. He's worthy of honor. Come on, open up your mouth right where you are. Lift your hands if you're in your car, if you're at home, if you're at work. Just take a moment and just begin to thank him for all that he's done, all that he's doing, and all that he's gonna do in the future. Can somebody just praise God? Come on, let everything that has breath praise ye the Lord. Come on, let everything that has breath praise ye the Lord. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Hallelujah to the Lamb of God. God, we thank you for your presence in this place. God, we thank you for allowing us another opportunity to gather together, Father, to hear and study your word. God, we thank you for the man of God as he brings the word. We pray that you will enable him to teach and preach with boldness and clarity. Father God, give us a word that will challenge and change us, Father. We don't want to leave the same way we came. Father, if someone is going through a storm right now, we pray that you would allow them to always know that you're with them. You'll never leave them. You'll never forsake them. God, we thank you in advance for what you're doing in our lives. God, we thank you in advance for what you're doing in our lives. God, we thank you for how you're moving. We thank you for how you're saving. We thank you for how you're sustaining us. Even in the midst of a pandemic, God, you are still providing for us. You're still taking good care of us, God. And we just want to say thank you. If we don't have anything else to say, all we can just do is lift our hands and say thank you. In Jesus' name we pray and give thanks. Hallelujah and amen. Come on, we want to celebrate a great God tonight. Anybody know he's great? Come on, anybody know he's great? Hallelujah, put your hands together. Come on, sing it with us. Say, is our God, sing with me, how great is our God, and all will see how great, everybody clap your hands. Come on, put your hands together if you know he's great, if you know he's mighty. Come on, sing it with us. Say, how great. It's our God.
It's our God.
Sing with me,
sing
how
me
great.
How great. Oh, our God.
And all will see how great.
How great.
How great. Now everybody clap your hands. Yeah. He's so amazing. Yes, he is. Yeah. Say how great. Amazing.
He's our God.
He's so amazing.
It's our God.
And I always
see
how great. Now everybody clap your hands. Come on, if you know he's great, won't you put your hands together? Yeah. Oh, this is my favorite part. I lift my hands.
To give you glory,
I lift my hands.
To give you
praise, and I'll praise you, Lord.
I'll praise you, Lord.
Will you praise, sing, yeah,
yeah,
yeah. I lift my hands. To give you glory,
I lift my hands.
Glory.
To give you glory.
I
praise you, Lord. I'll praise you, Lord. I'll praise you, Lord. I'll praise you, Lord.
Come on, clap your hands.
You're so amazing, God. Yeah. You are worthy of the glory. You are worthy of the glory. You are worthy of the glory. Yeah. So how great is our God? Say with me, how great is our God? And all will see how great is our God.
Praise the Lord, everybody. Come on, happy Wednesday night to everybody. This is the day that the Lord has made. We are rejoicing, we are glad in it. To God be all the glory. For the great things that God has done, the great things that God is doing, and the great things that God will continue to do. We don't just like to shout on Sunday. Welcome to the Wednesday night I study at the Star Bible Study. Millions didn't make it, but you are one of the ones who did. Listen, do me a favor. If you're watching us, for up-to-the-minute updates of all of the wonderful things going on at the Star, take out your cell phone, text the word STAR to 94253. At the expense of being redundant, I want to say it again, and I want to make sure that you share that message with everybody you know. So many people ask, you know, how can I remember everything that Pastor Beavers fires out? He fires it out just like that. The only thing that you have to do is make sure that you own our text thread. Text the word STAR to 94253. Listen, the Spirit of God hits you and you want to join, you don't even have to wait until the service is over. Take out your cell phone and text the word decision to 94253. Text the word decision to 94253. Within 48 hours, our team is going to contact you. Mark your calendars and save the date for this Saturday. This Saturday, 10 a.m. Central Standard Time is Star University. It is for all of our new members, and I want to make sure that you are present and accounted for. So text decision to 94253. Last but not least, it's giving time in the house of the Lord. And I want to say thank you for how it is that you have been faithful in honoring the Lord through the giving of your tithe and your offering. Salvation is free, but it costs to do ministry. Because of your generous gifts, the pandemic has not stopped any progress. Every Wednesday, speaking of Wednesday, today was off the chain, not only in Birmingham, but also in Lincoln, Alabama. Your giving fed not over 500 people, but over 500 families in Birmingham and Lincoln, Alabama. We were supposed to launch in Lincoln, Alabama on Easter, but it was interrupted because of COVID-19. Yet they are asking us, when are we going to launch? We could not do outreach like this without your giving. Several ways to be able to do it. So if you like to give in person, we have a drop box. Come up the church steps. Go to the left. Go to the brick part of the building. Look to the right. Just outside of the church office is the drop box. You can also give Monday through Friday, 9 a.m. to 4:30 p.m. and Sunday, 9 a.m. to 2 p.m. in person. Or you can mail it to 7400 London Avenue South, Birmingham, Alabama, 35206. Give online, beatmetothestar.net/give. Give by text. Text the amount that God has laid upon your heart to 855-912-7781. Cash app, $, beat me to the star, or Venmo at beat me to the star. So we've been in a new Wednesday series, an interactive series entitled Dr. Phil. Dr. Phil is an interactive series on the book of Philippians. And today I want you to open your Bibles to Philippians chapter number 1. Philippians chapter number 1, beginning with verse number 9. Philippians chapter 1. Tonight, we're going to read verses 9 through 18 as we are taking a deep dive into the book of Philippians. I want to begin with verse number 9. And this I pray, that your love may abound yet more and more in knowledge and in all judgment, that ye may approve things that are excellent, that ye may be sincere and without offense till the day of Christ,
being filled with the fruit of righteousness, which are by Jesus Christ unto the glory and praise of God. Verse number 12 declares, but I would ye should understand, brethren, that the things which happen unto me have fallen out rather unto the furtherance of the gospel. Verse number 13 declares, so that my bonds in Christ are manifest in all the palace and in all other places. Verse 14 declares, and many of the brethren in the Lord, waxing confident by my bonds, are much more bold to speak the word without fear. Some indeed preach Christ, even of envy and strife, some also of goodwill. Verse number 16 declares, the one preach Christ of contention, not sincerely supposing to add affliction to my bonds. Verse number 17, but the other of love, knowing that I am set for the defense of the gospel. I want to hang my hat on verse number 18. Verse 18, what then, notwithstanding every way, whether in pretense or in truth, Christ is preached, and I therein do rejoice, yea, and will rejoice. So tonight's lesson is a simple lesson entitled Prayer in Prison. Prayer and Prison. Let's bow our heads for a word of prayer. Heavenly Father, we honor you today. We glorify you. We praise you. We magnify you. You are so worthy to be praised above you. There is none other. From the rising of the sun into the going down of the same, you're worthy to be praised. From the east side to the west side, you are worthy to be praised. This is the day that you have made. We are rejoicing and we are glad in it. Give us clarity of thought, boldness of speech to proclaim the mysteries of your gospel. Except you say it, it won't be said. Except you teach it, it won't be taught. Except you preach it, it won't be preached. Except you do it, it won't be done. Open our ears to hear you. Open our eyes to see you. Open our hearts to receive you. Open our minds and grant us understanding. Prompt us to study on our own. Don't let us leave the same way that we've come, but let us leave forever changed. We will be forever careful and grateful to give you all the honor, all the glory, and all the praise. In the mighty and matchless name of your darling son, Jesus the Christ, who's able to do absolutely anything but fail. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. And amen. Tonight's lesson is a simple lesson entitled Prayer in Prison. Prayer in Prison. Many of you that are tuned in at this particular moment in time are familiar with the hit TV show entitled Dr. Phil. Dr. Phil used to be on a major cable network. Now it is on the OWN network. The OWN network stands for the Oprah Winfrey Network. Shout out to Oprah Winfrey. This message is not about Oprah Winfrey. This message is an interactive series on the book of Philippians. It is quite interesting to note that Dr. Phil is in fact a psychologist, and everyone who comes onto his show is his patient. He's the doctor. Patients come onto the show that he might be able to help them in various ways, various forms, various shapes, and various fashions. As this pertains to a spiritual sense, tonight we're really not here to talk about Dr. Phil from a secular standpoint, but tonight we are here to continue to move through an interactive study on the book of Philippians. Phil is short for Philippians. It is quite interesting to note that when it is that you crack open the book of Philippians, when it is that you survey the book of Philippians, Philippians is the audience, or Philippians is the patient. Philippians, or Philippi, is the city to which Paul the Apostle is writing to at this particular moment in time. But the doctor, ladies and gentlemen, is not Paul. The doctor is the great physician who's never lost a patient. His name is Jesus the Christ, Son of the Living God. You already learned on last week that it is absolutely impossible to understand the book of Philippians without moonwalking back to Acts chapter number 16. So you already know, in Acts chapter number 16, around verse number 25, the Bible declares, and at midnight, Paul and Silas prayed and sang praises unto God, and the other prisoners heard them. Hold up, wait a minute, stop it. Acts chapter number 16, Paul and Silas find themselves in prison. Why are they in prison? Not because they've done something wrong, but because they've decided to stand for Jesus. Standing for Jesus got them into trouble. And I want to say, somebody, there is a common theme throughout the New Testament, a common thread throughout the New Testament that those who live godly shall suffer persecution. So if you have confessed with your mouth the Lord Jesus, believed inside of your heart that God raised Jesus from the dead, and you only did it because you wanted glory, not because you wanted God to get the glory, you are in it for the wrong reason. Please do not think that the moment you are saved, sanctified, and filled with the precious gift of the Holy Spirit, that you never have to go through a trial, you never have to go through a setback or a circumstance. But Paul and Silas teach all of us that those who live godly shall suffer persecution. So they find themselves in prison at midnight and in a dark and a dire situation. They prayed and sang praises unto God. Now, I already know that this is eisegesis. Paul starts with a P, Silas starts with an S. So maybe Paul prayed and Silas was the one who sang praises unto God. We really don't know who was praying and who was singing. The only thing that we know is that they prayed. Perhaps both of them were doing it at the same time, and they sang praises unto God. This was not a quiet prayer and praise. This was loud because the Bible declares that other prisoners heard them. Come a little bit closer on tonight. Here's the issue that I have with so many Christians. The issue that I have with so many Christians is not that you're not a praiser, is not that you don't sing, but the issue that I have with so many Christians, you only praise God when you feel as if nobody else is looking. You only make a joyful noise when you feel as if nobody else is listening to you. But David said that praise is not for spectators, it is for participators. This is the reason he said, oh, magnify the Lord with me. And that's exactly what Paul and Silas did together. The other prisoners heard them. God sent an earthquake. Immediately, everyone's bands were loose. So they walk out of the prison. There is a keeper of the jail who brings them out of the prison. His life is in danger. Why is his life in danger? His life is in danger because his sole responsibility is to make sure that Paul and Silas do not get out. But he cannot contend with the supernatural power of the Holy Ghost. So they walk out of the prison. He fears for his life. He says, sirs, talking to Paul and Silas, what must I do to be saved? They say, believe on the name of the Lord and be baptized. And from that moment forward, he and his entire house were baptized. He and his entire house were saved. Why is that important? That is important because Acts 16, verses 31 through 32 is the beginning of the church at Philippi. When the Philippian jailkeeper and his entire house got saved, that is the birthing of the church at Philippi. So we learned on last week that the church at Philippi was birthed out of a dark and a dire situation. Why do you say that it's a dark situation? It happened at midnight. Why do you say it's a dire situation? It is a dire situation because it happened while Paul and Silas were in prison. As a consequence, when Paul and Timothy write to the church at Philippi, in Philippians chapter number 1, Paul is writing from prison. So here's an interesting footnote that is not inside of my notes. Paul founded and established the church at Philippi while he was in prison. And now that he's writing back to the church at Philippi, in his absence away from the church at Philippi, he's remembering the church at Philippi while he's in prison all at the same time. And when he opens up in Philippians chapter number 1, he opens up praying for the church. Hence the reason that tonight's message is a simple message entitled Prayer in Prison. So you learned on last week, he opens up praying for the church. He prays for their continued fellowship in the gospel, number one. He also prays that God will perform the work and complete the work that he started inside of them. But after he prays for their continued fellowship in the gospel, and after he prays that God will perform and complete the work that he started inside of them, he then continues this prayer in Philippians chapter number 1. Verse number 9, and that's why I want to pick up on tonight. Put it up in the back so everybody can see it. Philippians 1, verse 9. Paul says, and this I pray, that your love may abound yet the more and more in knowledge and in all judgment. And this I pray, that your love may abound, that your love may increase. That's what it means to abound, yet the more and more in knowledge and in all judgment. So Paul is continuing his prayer. Number one, he prayed for their continued fellowship in the gospel. Number two, he prayed that Christ will complete and finish the work that God started inside of them. But then he prayed, watch this, that your love may abound yet more and more in knowledge and in all judgment, which says to all of us that post-salvation. What do you mean, Dr. Beavers, post-salvation? Now that they have been saved, he's praying for their continued growth in Christ after salvation. Post-salvation, Paul prayed for the church at Philippi to grow in love, and he prayed that they would grow in their knowledge of Christ. So now that you are saved, I'm praying for your continued growth in Christ. And I want you to understand that Paul is not the only shepherd who's praying for the sheep. I, Pastor Beavers, am your shepherd, and I'm praying for the sheep. Now that you have been saved, sanctified, filled with the precious gift of the Holy Spirit, fire baptized and on the Lord's side, I refuse to allow you to sit under my teaching and my tutelage and for you to stay where you are. In other words, you might be on one level today, but although you are on one level today, you're not going to be on the same level tomorrow. I am praying for your continued growth. And the same way that after salvation, Paul prayed for the church at Philippi to grow in their love and to grow in their knowledge of Christ is the same way on tonight. I'm praying for you. Now that you have been saved, I'm praying for your sanctification, the process of you becoming more and more like Jesus Christ. And I'm praying for you to grow in your love for Christ. And I'm also praying for you to grow in your knowledge for Christ. So watch this. Whenever you love God, but you do not have knowledge, hear this clearly, you have zeal, but you do not have knowledge. And whenever you have zeal, but you do not have knowledge, you end up hurting people. Let me give you this example before I move to the next verse. If you have an ailment inside of your body and you have to go to the hospital, 9 times out of 10, you're going to have surgery. It does not matter how much love and passion the surgeon has to perform surgery. If they have not gone through 4 years of college, 4 years of medical school, 3 years of residency, you are not going to perform surgery on my body. Why is that? Because you have a love and a passion for it, but you don't have the knowledge to carry it out. Watch this. Love without knowledge hurts people. This is the reason that Paul the Apostle is praying for them. Now that you have been saved, I pray that you grow in your love for Christ, but I also pray that you grow in your knowledge for Christ, that you may be useful to the body of Christ, fit for the master's use. He then says in Philippians chapter 1, verse 10, put it up in the back so everybody can see it. He says that ye may approve things that are excellent, that ye may be sincere and without offense, till the day of Christ. He says that you may approve things that are excellent. So first he prays for your continued knowledge in Christ, your continued love in Christ, but he then prays that you may approve things that are excellent, that ye may be sincere and without offense till the day of Christ, which says to all of us, post-salvation, Paul prayed for the church at Philippi to understand what matters most. I'm going to say it again. Post-salvation, Paul prayed for the church at Philippi to understand what matters most. Now, Dr. Beavers, where do you get that from? Because I don't see that anywhere inside of that verse. That's because you're reading from the King James Version. The King James Version is a word-for-word translation. Sometimes it's good to read it from the New Living Translation, which happens to be a thought-for-thought translation. And when you read this same verse from the New Living Translation, post-salvation, Paul prayed for the church at Philippi. In other words, he's saying, I'm praying that you understand what matters most. So here it is as he continues his prayer. He's praying for you to grow in your love for God, grow in your knowledge for God, and for you to understand what matters most. He then says in Philippians chapter number 1, I believe we're still in verse number 10, or are we in verse number 11? So I'm still in verse number 10. He says, Philippians chapter number 1, verse 10, he says, that ye may approve things that are excellent, that ye may approve things that are excellent, that ye may be sincere and without offense till the day of Christ. The shepherd is praying for the sheep. And what is Paul praying for the sheep? Number one, that you grow in your love for God. Number two, that you grow in your knowledge for God. Number three, that you understand what matters the most. Number four, watch this, abounding in love coupled with the knowledge and understanding of Christ enables us to live in purity until the day of Christ's return. So as we abound in love, as well as growing our knowledge and understanding of Christ, it enables us to live in purity until the day of Christ's return. So in Philippians chapter number 1, verse 10, he says, I'm praying that you approve things that are excellent, that you understand what matters the most, that you may be sincere and without offense till the day of Christ. If you read this from the New Living Translation, Paul the Apostle is writing to the church at Philippi, and he's saying, I'm praying that as you grow in your love for Christ, and I'm praying that as you grow in your knowledge and understanding for Christ, here's how I know that you're growing in love, knowledge, and understanding of Jesus the Christ, Son of the living God. It's going to enable you to live in purity until the day of Christ's return. So a whole lot of people are talking about, I love God. A whole lot of people are talking about, I know God. But the question has to be raised, does the love that you claim to have translate in the life that you are living? Does the knowledge that you claim to have translate in the life that you are living? I want to ask that question not just to you. I want to ask it to me. Does the love that I claim to have for God translate in the life that I am living? Does the knowledge that I claim to have for God translate in the life that I am living? In other words, I want to say it like this. How can I love God whom I've never seen and hate my brother that I see every day? So if I love God and I'm growing in my knowledge for God, growing in my understanding for God, it enables me to live in purity unto the day of Christ's return. Let's go to verse number 11, Philippians chapter number 1. He says, being filled with the fruits of righteousness, being filled with the fruits of righteousness, which are by Jesus Christ unto the glory and praise of God. Which says to all of us post-salvation, Paul prayed for the church at Philippi to be fruitful. Post-salvation, Paul prayed for the church at Philippi to be fruitful. Why is that important, Dr. Beavers? It is important because many of us think that my only responsibility is to be faithful. But I contend on tonight that if we are faithful to God, being faithful will produce fruit inside of our life. Now, what fruit am I talking about? Paul says in Philippians chapter number 1, verse number 11, he says, I'm praying that you be filled with the fruits of righteousness. What are the fruits of righteousness? Another word for the fruits of righteousness are the fruit of the Spirit. I want to give you this cross scripture. It's not in my notes, but it is on my heart. Galatians 5 verses 22 through 23. Galatians 5 verses 22 through 23. Love, joy, peace, long-suffering, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, kindness, self-control. Let me back it on up like a U-Haul truck because somebody just missed it. Come on, I need you to type this in the comment section. Love, joy, peace, long-suffering, which is patience. Everybody wants long-suffering, but nobody wants to suffer long. Love, joy, peace, long-suffering, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, kindness, and self-control. So in other words, if I grow in my love for God, if I grow in my knowledge for God, if I grow in my understanding for God, I understand what matters the most, and in turn, because of my faithfulness towards God, it produces fruit inside of my life. The fruit that I'm talking about is the fruit of righteousness, the fruit of the Spirit, love, joy, peace, long-suffering, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, kindness, self-control. He then says in Philippians chapter number 1, around verse number 12, Philippians 1, around verses 12. Let's go 12 through 13. 12 through 13. He says, but I would you understand, brethren, that the things which happen unto me. So dig this. He's making a shift. First, he was praying. But now after he finishes his prayer, he starts talking about his condition. What is his condition? He's in prison. So he says in 12 through 13, but I would that you understand, brethren, that the things which happen unto me have fallen out, rather unto the furtherance of the gospel, so that my bonds in Christ, my chains in Christ, are manifest in all the palace and in all other places. I want to read it one more time. Philippians 1, verses 12 through 13. Let's read it together. You can hear me, but I can't hear you. Come on, one, two, ready, read. But I would ye should understand, brethren, that the things which happened unto me have fallen out rather unto the furtherance of the gospel, so that my bonds in Christ are manifest in all the palace and in all other places. So after he talks about prayer, he starts shifting the topic to his current situation. His current situation is prison. Now, this is significant because you already know from Acts chapter number 16, he founded and established this church out of a dark and dire situation. It's midnight, that's why it's dark, and it's dire because he's in prison. So he founded and established the church when that Philippian jailer was saved, he and his entire family, while he was in prison. So years have passed, and now he's writing to remember this church. And while he's writing to remember this church, he's writing to remember it from prison, which says to all of us that God never wastes an opportunity to further his gospel and to expand his kingdom. What he's really saying to the church at Philippi is, don't feel sorry for me. Yes, I am in prison. Not because I've done something wrong, but because I decided to follow Jesus. Yes, I am in prison. Not because of chastisement, but because of persecution. In other words, I'm in trouble not because I did something wrong. I'm in trouble because I decided to follow Jesus. And following Jesus got me in prison. But although I am in prison, he says, don't feel sorry for me. Now, here's the kicker. Paul has a faith that is so strong. Normally, when somebody goes to prison, those of us outside of the prison are writing inside of the prison to encourage the ones who are inside of the prison. But his faith is so strong that although he's in the prison, he's writing from in the prison outside of the prison to encourage the believers at the church at Philippi. Watch this. While he's in prison himself, I want to ask you this question. How strong is your faith? Is your faith strong enough to encourage other people while you are going through dark and dire situations yourself? Is your faith strong enough to encourage other people while you are going through yourself? Now, Paul, how is it that you can encourage somebody else while you yourself are going through? He's encouraging other people while he himself is going through because Paul understands that God never wastes an opportunity, whether it seems to be good or whether it seems to be bad, to further his gospel and to expand his kingdom. He says, I'm in the prison, but the gospel is still moving forward. I'm in the prison, but the kingdom of God is still expanding. God never wastes an opportunity to further his gospel and to expand his kingdom. He's really echoing the sentiments of what he wrote to the church at Rome when he wrote in Romans chapter number 8, verse 28. This scripture is not in my notes, but it's on my heart. Write it down. Romans 8 and 28, he says, watch this, and we know that all things are working together for the good of those who love God, for those who are called according to his purpose. In other words, it might not feel good, but it's working for my good. It doesn't feel good for Paul to be in prison because he didn't do anything wrong, but it's working for his good and for the glory of Jesus Christ because God is using it to further his kingdom. I want to speak to somebody on tonight. Every dark and dire situation you find yourself in, as long as we stay submitted to the Spirit of God and surrender to God, God will use our dark and dire situations to further and to expand his kingdom. He then says in Philippians chapter number 1 around verse number 14. Let's go there on tonight. He says, and many of the brethren in the Lord waxing confident by my bonds, I'm much more bold to speak the word without fear. I want to read that again. And many of the brethren in the Lord, waxing confident by my bonds, are much more bold to speak the word without fear. So the question has to be raised, God, how are you using Paul's prison situation to further and to expand your kingdom? I'm glad you asked. What that says to all of us is that often God allows our trials to be on public display to build faith in other people. Often God will allow my personal trials to be on public display for the purpose of building faith in other people. In other words, Paul says, I'm in prison and I don't have the privilege of being in prison and going through this moment privately. Everyone knows that I'm in prison. Those people are on the outside looking in, wanting to know how I'm going to handle this situation. But as they see that I have been bold to preach the gospel, and the fact that I've been thrown in prison, but I did not allowed the prison to cause me to shrink back from sharing the gospel, from being a witness of the gospel, from preaching the gospel, they're looking at me and they saying, man, if you were that bold, so much to the point that you were thrown in prison, but you still didn't shut your mouth, then guess what? If you can have that level of boldness to preach the gospel and it gets you in prison and you still didn't stop, then guess what? I'm going to be bold as well. In other words, often God allows our trials to be on public display. That's what God is allowing for Paul. He's allowing his personal trial in prison to be on public display. But as other people are looking at him and watching how he handles this prison situation and how he goes through it, it is building other people's faith. Now, I want to give you this cross-reference scripture. It's not in my notes, but it's on my heart. Write this down on tonight. Revelation chapter 12, verse 11. Revelation chapter number 12, verse 11. And we overcome, or they overcame, by the blood of the Lamb and by the word of their testimony. They overcame by the blood of the Lamb and the word of their testimony. The blood of the Lamb has already been shed. The only thing left to do is to share our testimony. And as other people watch us go through our test, it helps them to overcome. That's exactly what's going on in Philippians chapter number 1, verse 14. Let's go to verse number 15 on tonight. Philippians 1, verses 15 through 16. I want to read that together. Some indeed preach Christ, even of envy and strife. It's not about what you do, it's about why you do it. And some also of goodwill. The one preach Christ of contention, not sincerely supposing to add affliction to my bonds. Let's read that again. Some indeed preach Christ, even of envy and strife, and some also of goodwill. The one preach Christ of contention, not sincerely, supposing to add affliction to my bonds. Which says to all of us, it is possible to preach Christ with wrong motives. It is possible to preach Christ with wrong motives. So watch this. I'm in prison. I'm preaching Christ. The gospel is moving forward. It's giving other people confidence. Okay. Maybe you don't know the term being confident. I want to give you this term. I know you can recognize this. When other people see Paul in prison and the gospel going forward and he's still bold, it's putting do it fluid inside of everybody else. So everybody else outside of the prison has this do it fluid because Paul is bold. It's making everybody else bold who's outside of the prison and they're preaching Christ. But although they are preaching Christ, everybody is not doing it with pure motives. Paul says, some indeed preach Christ, even of envy and of strife. In other words, they are envious of me, envious of my position as an apostle, envious of the following that I have. And now that I'm in prison and I can't physically touch my congregation, they are jealous and they are envious. So much to the point that they're trying to steal my members while I am in prison. Some are preaching out of envy. Some are preaching out of strife. In other words, they're trying to get back at me. Because watch this. The more influence that God gives you, the more you become a target to other people. And some also of goodwill. The one preach Christ of contention, not sincerely supposing to add to my affliction. Which says to all of us, it is possible to preach Christ, which is the right thing, but to do it with wrong motives. He then says in Philippians 1, I think I'm in the same scripture. You can go ahead and move to the next. Philippians 1, verse number 17, he says, but the other of love, knowing that I am set for the defense of the gospel. So some are preaching Christ, which is the right thing, but with wrong motives because they're doing it out of envy, out of strife, with contention, supposing that they're going to get me back because I'm in prison. But then you have some other people who also have some do it fluid, who are bold, and they are preaching Christ, which is the right thing, and they're also doing it with right motives. Come a little bit closer. Only what you do for Christ will last. They are doing it with right motives because they are doing it out of love. So although it's possible to preach Christ with wrong motives, it's best to preach Christ with right motives. Put that up in the back so everybody can see it. Although it's possible to preach Christ with wrong motives, if we want to get credit when we see Jesus face to face on the day of judgment, it's best to preach Christ with right motives. Okay? Let's conclude in verse number 18. Let's conclude verse number 18. What then, notwithstanding, every way, whether in pretense or in truth, Christ is preached, and I therein do rejoice, yeah, and will rejoice. What then, notwithstanding, every way, whether in pretense or in truth, Christ is preached, and I therein do rejoice. Yeah, and I will rejoice. What Paul is really saying is, I don't care why you preach Christ. Now, you need to be careful to make sure you preach it with right motives, because guess what? On the day of judgment, when we see Jesus face to face, he's not just judging us for rewards by what we do. He's judging us for levels of rewards in heaven according to the motives behind what we do. So we can do the right thing with the wrong motive and still not get a reward in heaven because our motives were off. But Paul says, while I am on this earth, I don't really care what your motives are, because guess what? It works out to the glory of God as long as Christ is preached. Which says to all of us, regardless of motive, when Christ is preached, the gospel is spread and God's kingdom is expanded. I'm going to say it again. Regardless of motive, when Christ is preached, the gospel is spread and the kingdom is advanced. So I want to give you a quick recap on tonight. We start out with Paul's prayer. Beginning with verse number 9, he's finishing up his prayer. He prays for a couple of things. Number one, he says, I'm praying for your continued fellowship in the gospel. We learned that last week. He says, I'm praying that Christ will finish the work that he started. But then he says, I'm praying that you grow in your love for God. I'm praying that you grow in your knowledge and understanding for God. I'm praying that you grow in your understanding of what matters the most. And he says, as you grow in your love, your knowledge, and understanding for God, it ought to show up in the way that you live, because it shall produce fruit inside of your life. Not grapes, oranges, apples, and strawberry, but the fruit of righteousness, the fruit of the Spirit, love, joy, peace, long-suffering, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, kindness, and self-control. Then he comes out of his prayer and he starts talking about his prison situation. He says, don't feel sorry for me. What Satan meant for evil, God is using it for my good. I want to say to somebody, stop feeling sorry for yourself. What Satan meant for evil, God is using it. He's using it for your good. He says, this happened for the furtherance of the gospel. Then he says, because of my boldness, everyone's watching me go through this situation. They're watching how I deal with it. They're watching how I handle this situation. And guess what? It's putting that do it fluid inside of them as well. They're becoming bold. Therefore, they are preaching Christ. Some are doing it out of contention to get me back. God has given me a tremendous amount of influence and has put a target on my back. Sometimes the own brethren, the preach brethren, don't like me. He says, but I'm still preaching. Some people preach Christ the right thing with wrong motives. And then some people preach Christ out of love, the right thing with right motives. He says, I don't care why you do it, as long as you do it, that God may be glorified. Let's pray. Father, in the name of Jesus, we honor you, God. We praise you. We magnify you. You are so worthy to be praised. From the rising of the sun into the going down of the same, you're worthy to be praised. From the east side to the west side, you're worthy to be praised. This is the day that you have made. We are rejoicing. We are glad in it. Thank you for allowing us to dive deep into this interactive study on the book of Philippians. Unlike Dr. Phil, Jesus, you are the great physician. The church at Philippi, those of us that are studying, we are the patients. Thank you that you have prayed for us. You, the great shepherd. There's anybody who's tuned in who does not know you in the free pardoning of their sins. I pray that you would save them right now, but they confess with their mouth that you, Jesus, are Lord. Believe in their heart that God raised you, Jesus, from the dead. I pray that you would save them. You're tuned in and the Spirit is speaking to you. Say this prayer, Jesus, thank you for dying for my sins. Thank you for allowing yourself to be buried. Thank you for getting up on the third day with all power in your hands. Come into my heart. I make you the Lord of my life. If I'm saved but I've strayed away, I renew my commitment to you. If I'm saved but I don't have a church, beat me to the star. I've decided to follow you, Jesus, all the days of my life. In Jesus' name, amen. If you made that decision, take out your cell phone, text the word decision to 94253. Text the word decision to 94253. Within 48 hours, our team is going to contact you. Mark your calendar and save the date for this Saturday, 10 a.m. Central Standard Time. We want to take you through Star University, our version of new members. It's going to be virtual. And I want to see your face in the place this Saturday. Last but not least, thank you for how it is you've been faithful in honoring the Lord through the giving of your tithe and your offering. If you like to give in person, feel free to give in person. We have a drop box that is open 24 hours a day, Monday through Friday, 9 a.m. to 4:30 p.m. We are open. You can come give in person. Sunday, 9 a.m. to 2 p.m. we're open. You can come give in person. You can mail it to 7400 London Avenue, South Birmingham, Alabama, 35206. Give online, www.beatmetothestar.net/give. Give by text. Text the amount that God has laid upon your heart to 855-912-7781. Cash App, $BeatMeToTheStar, or Venmo at Beat Me to the Star. Lord, take us from this place, but never from your presence. Bless the gifts and the givers. May they be used for the edification and the upbuilding of your kingdom. Now unto him that's able to keep us from falling and to present us faultless before his presence with exceeding great joy. To the only wise God, our Savior, be the glory, majesty, dominion, and power both now and forevermore. And everyone that agreed with this prayer, shout amen, amen, and amen. God bless you. I love you. Peace. See you Sunday.